Hello, everyone. My name is Doug Penrod. I'm a transplant nurse coordinator and outreach liaison at the Transplant Center at Northwestern Memorial Hospital. Today, I'm going to be talking about kidney and pancreas transplants and what all is involved in evaluation and that type of thing, and how we do things and a little bit about Northwestern Memorial Hospital. We were the first center to do a transplant in Illinois in February of 1964. We did the first kidney pancreas transplant in the state in November of 1970. Since then, the program has been very active, done over 5,500 actually kidney transplants now, 2,800 from living donors, and more than 770 pancreas transplants. And that's the most in the state of any of the 8 transplant centers. We also have the largest in-center kidney pair donation program in Illinois, where we are able to use a program that will swap donors to make people compatible, recipients compatible if they're not. We also have the longest and largest cohort of patients in the world right now who are totally off all of their immunosuppressive medications as a result of very innovative stem cell and kidney transplant research. Most are over 10 years out now, and one of them 2 years ago, a young nurse actually, had a baby, which is the first baby ever born in someone who's had a stem cell and a kidney transplant. Our program is quite big. We have a lot of transplant nephrologists, hepatologists for the liver side, and we also have quite a few transplant surgeons, and I'm not going to go through them name by name, but undoubtedly, you will meet more than one of these during your transplant time at Northwestern. We also have a very large team that goes along with that, and including 4 advanced practice providers, in other words, nurse practitioners. We have 10 transplant coordinators just for pre-transplant, 5 transplant assistants to assist them. We have 5 transplant social workers, and we also have an independent living donor advocate. Well, what's that? Well, we have an entirely separate program for people who are considering either a liver donation or a kidney donation to someone. And they have their own independent living donor team. It includes its own transplant nurse coordinators, transplant assistants, and a social worker and ILDA for these donors, which is completely separate from the recipient program. To offer you a little better availability of getting your pre-transplant started, we have now for the past 15 years run a series of satellite clinics where you can go and avoid that trip downtown here that many people don't want to make. And go to a center that might be closer to you to get your evaluation started. Besides the downtown campus, we also have satellites in Deerfield, Huntley, Oak Brook, Crest Hill, which is close to Joliet, Oaklawn, St. John, Indiana, and Chesterton. Any of these clinics can be booked by calling just one number, 312-695-0828. So what are your treatment options for kidney failure? There are many, actually. One is to do nothing, but that option is not a very good one, though some patients do take it, because in the end, you're going to die, unfortunately. Dialysis is life-saving. The first dialysis done here in Illinois was in March of 1959. Also here at Northwestern. There's several types of dialysis. Most prevalent right now is hemodialysis in center, but now there's also a growing home hemodialysis program. and also a peritoneal dialysis program, which can be done at home. And these are gaining popularity now. But by far, your best option is to get a kidney transplant, because not only are you going to have a better quality of life, but if your health is otherwise fairly decent, you're going to live longer. And there you have options also. By far, most patients get a deceased donor kidney transplant. Results are really very good, which I'm going to show you later on in this talk. But the problem is currently, it's a 6 to 8 year wait here in our organ bank district. And we'll talk more about that later also. A living donor transplant, however, can be accomplished in 90 to 120 days. Doesn't have to be a relative. It can be anybody who is a good medical candidate for donation and is compatible. And I'll talk more about compatibility later, but you've got to be compatible with two things: the DNA of the recipient and also the blood type. And that's where our kidney paired donation program and something called desensitization enter. And basically this is, you've got a donor that's fine medically, but your blood types don't match. So what then? Well, years ago, we'd say, fine, you're going to have to find another donor, and we had no such thing as paired donation. Today, we'll put you into one of our paired donation as long as you and the donor are agreeing to accept a kidney from someone else and the donor donating to someone else. And again, we'll have more information on this later. Desensitization is actually a medical procedure where in some instances, we can actually use this procedure to make you compatible with the DNA of your recipient or to overcome blood type incompatibilities also. Recipients of kidney transplants are broken down by age group in terms of how long do I have on dialysis and how long would I have if I got a kidney instead. Now, this data is based on the United States Renal Data System, which came up with this in 2014 based on estimates from the 2012 Renal Data System ADR, which is their annual disease report. And in this particular case, the orange line shows by age group what's your expected life survival is on dialysis versus the blue line, which says what it would be with a kidney transplant, theoretically. There is some variations in all of this, and this is not something you can go, well, I only have, you know, 32 years and 8 months to live when I get a kidney transplant. That's not true. Our longest patient out just in July of 2020 hit 50 years with a kidney transplant. But I'm going to take my age. I'm 74 now. And so if I look at my chart there, 70 to 74, my life expectancy on dialysis is less than 4 years. And if I get a transplant, it's 10.8 or so. However, if I were half my age, don't I wish, let's say in the 35 to 39 group, my life expectancy on dialysis would be 12 years, but it would be over 32 if I were to get a successful kidney transplant. So this is definitely the younger you are, the longer you have for survival, which is the way everything is in life, it seems like. So, but these definitely prove that kidney transplant, if you're otherwise healthy enough to get one, is what you should be considering as your number one option. It improves your quality of life, lengthens it compared to dialysis, and the benefits of transplant generally outweigh the risks for most patients. But there are risks with kidney transplant. The surgery itself is still considered major surgery after all these years. The first transplant, by the way, was done in 1954 in Boston. The surgical risk, it takes 3 to 4 hours to do this surgery, and anytime you have to go under general anesthesia, you're at risk. Medical effects of this can also be detrimental. The immunosuppression drugs that we use to keep the transplant working can cause problems with your immune system in terms of letting loose viruses that would normally be dormant in your body. But now, because of what the immunosuppressive drugs do, they can reappear again. There are also psychosocial risks associated with getting a kidney transplant. This is hard work. You need support throughout this first year or so to help you get through this with your medications and any other problems that might come up. So you have to be sound and have good family support to be able to get a kidney transplant. And finally, there can be a problem with the organ itself. Now, today we all know about COVID-19, and we've been through the AIDS epidemic years ago, and also Hep C and Hep B, but yet these are still concerns for us today. Nothing's changed. And unfortunately, we're seeing a lot more donors who come with some of these diseases. They've either had them or cleared them, and now we're using them for transplant. So there is an increased chance of infection, not only from your donor organ, but also just in general, once you've gotten a transplant and you're immunosuppressed because it protects you from viruses. Cancer is another thing that you're gonna be more predisposed to have than if you didn't get a transplant due to the immunosuppressive drugs. The number one is skin cancers. Basal cell carcinoma and squamous cell carcinoma, which can generally just be scraped off or burn off or something like that. But there are other kinds like malignant melanoma, which can kill you if you get them. So this is something you have to be aware of. You have to keep your cancer screenings up. For colon cancer, colorectal cancer, and all the assorted others, lung and that type of thing. So there's always a downside to a good thing, and there's risk with everything that appears in life. So how do you get started? You're interested in a kidney transplant, but you don't know what you're supposed to do. What's the next step? How do you get on a waiting list? Well, are you a candidate? The only way you're going to know that is to go to a transplant center and have a pre-kidney transplant evaluation done. And I will be quite frank with you. Most centers follow the same guidelines regarding what testing is going to be done. And so if you're thinking about being on more than one center's list, which we'll talk about, you might want to go to more than one center and then start your evaluation at one and see if the other one will accept it. But is it gonna involve a lot of blood tests to begin with? And then of course, a thorough cardiac screening and also your cancer screenings. If there's anything special about some of the diseases you might have, like lupus or one of the autoimmune diseases, that may be something we also want to delve in a little bit further. The biggest thing is trying to get your testing completed, especially in the days of COVID now. 12 weeks is what we'd like to get this accomplished in. However, we know today that this can sometimes be difficult to get the testing scheduled, for you to get rides or whatever. So we will work with you on this. But the faster you get the testing done, the faster you'll be able to get on the transplant list or get a living donor transplant. Now, the wait list for a kidney transplant is different from that for a liver and a heart. And kidney and pancreas generally go together on one separate list, and then there's a whole kidney list that is separate by itself. And it's broken down, the list is by organ bank, by transplant center, then by region, and then by country, okay? Talk about that a little bit more. Currently, the waiting time is basically the number one determinant of when you get a kidney transplant. We're all used to waiting in line for something, today even more. So once you get on the list, your waiting time starts. However, if you were previously on dialysis, under the allocation rules that went into effect in 2014, you now get credit for your time on dialysis. So let's say you've been on dialysis for 3 years, and you come to a transplant center, and they put you on, 6 months later, you get on the list. Well, it's not the time you get on the list that becomes your official waiting time. It's the day you started dialysis 3 years ago. So you have 3 years right there. Now, there's also a difference in pediatric patients. Pediatric patients always get precedent over adults for kidneys. I have news for you. There's not that many of them, and that's good. That's below 18. And many of them get live donor transplants, so they don't take up a huge amount. Matching, the DNA matching that's done between donor and recipient, can also play a role. Some particular matches get special attention, and we're going to talk a little bit more about matching here shortly. Antibodies, and antibodies we're talking about here are those that you have against another human being's DNA, which could cause incompatibility. And if you have very high antibody levels, which is going to mean you're going to have a more difficult time finding a compatible donor, then you're going to get more points on the waiting list so that you're exposed to more donors. Again, waiting time starts either when you're receiving dialysis. You can get on the wait list the day you started dialysis. If you're not receiving dialysis, and it's preemptive, which we'd like to do everyone that way, the requirement is a GFR, glomerular filtration rate, of 20 or less. Most patients do not start dialysis until they're under 10 in terms of GFR. It gives you a little bit of time, especially if you have a living donor option. That's a very good thing. We can get you transplanted, hopefully, before you need to go on dialysis. If not, you will have to go on dialysis. So what are all these matches I've been talking about with donor and recipient? Well, the first one is blood type. And here it's pretty easy. There's only four blood types. A, B, A, B, and O. And that little positive or negative afterwards, forget about it. We don't care. In transplant, it makes no difference. That's only in transfusions and pregnancies do they care about the what we call the Rh factor. Positive or negative. I'm a blood type O, so if I would donate, I would be able to donate to any of the other blood groups. I'm what's known as a universal donor. Unfortunately, I can only get a kidney from another blood type O. So an A can donate to an A or an AB, a B can donate to a B or an AB, but an O can only get from another O, and an AB blood type can get one from anybody. Now, they only make up about 5% or less of the population. Bs are about 15, and it's a split between Os and As. And since Os can go to anybody, they do not cross over and go to any of the other blood types unless there's a special match that occurs. And the match, in terms of your DNA, is what we call human leukocytic antigen, or HLA. These antigens, and there's six of them, actually arise on your DNA on a chromosome. And we're able to identify these six antigens, of which we match donor and recipient. And guess what? If the donor and recipient match all six, it's what we call a perfect match. I don't entirely agree with this diagnosis as a perfect match, but it's only seen between siblings, and here's why. You get three antigens from mom, and you get three from dad. So the best match you could ever be for a parent would be a half match at best. However, if you have four siblings, chances are one of those four got the same three from mom and dad that you did, and therefore they are a perfect match. And years ago, when we didn't have good immunosuppressive drugs, or a lot of them, we would look for that six antigen match as a way of matching our way out of rejection. Today, we don't care what your match is, because a 0 out of 6 does about as well as a 5 out of 6. So we take whatever we can get, and what actually determines if you're compatible is something we call a cross match, which is the last thing that's done on any live donor kidney transplant or any deceased donor kidney transplant. And this is basically a test where we take blood from the donor, we mix it with blood from the recipient in a special machine called a flow cytometer, and then it tells us, is it safe to do a transplant from this donor without them rejecting the organ right on the operating room table? And it actually gives us numbers. And before, as long as they're below a certain point, then yes, we're able to use that organ. However, if it's what is called a positive cross match, and the recipient's immune system has just gone nuts when it was exposed to the antigens from the donor, that's what we call a positive cross match. And therefore, we would not take that organ because there would be almost no chance that it was going to work. So, I'm a blood type O. My sister wants to donate a kidney to me. She's an A. That's not going to work. And this scenario came up back in 2004 at Johns Hopkins. And as all the centers did at that time, well, if you didn't have a compatible blood type, find another donor. Sorry. But they decided they had two donor pairs. They had donor one and recipient one. One was a B to an A, which is incompatible. But they had another pair they were working at the same time that had just the opposite problem. The donor was an A and the recipient was a B. And somebody said, hey, why don't we ask these two donor-recipient pairs if they would just like to swap donors? They would be compatible ABO. We can do the cross match to make sure that the DNA HLA is okay. And so they did. It worked. They did a few studies. We heard about it in 2006. And our own donor paired kidney program here. And it proved to be a godsend. And why? Because the wait for a deceased donor has gone up and up from 6 to 8 years now here in the United States. In January, there were over 91,000 people waiting for a kidney transplant on the list. In Illinois alone, more than 3,300. In 2020, we did 17,583 kidney transplants in the United States at some 250 transplant centers. We did over 5,234 live donor transplants in that year. And this was a new record, quite frankly, in a COVID year for us doing transplants, that in 2019, which is unbelievable. At the same time, many patients still will die on the kidney transplant waiting list long before they get a deceased donor kidney. And that's what we're trying to avoid at this time. I want to tell you, when we talked about the allocation system of waiting lists being the prime determinant, right now we are 2 weeks into a new allocation policy on kidney transplants that's totally kind of turned around the way things are done. And the reason for the changes were instituted because of demographic disparities in where you lived made a determination of how long you're going to wait. If you lived in Wisconsin in one of their two organ banks, your wait could be as little as 3 years or less, when here it was 6 years. If you lived in Iowa, it could even be less than that. It might be a couple years. So the allocation system was changed 2 weeks ago, and we're starting to see a big increase in the number of kidney offers that we're receiving now with the way they've redone the what we call donor service area for each kidney donor. Now, it's too early to tell if this is going to make any significant difference, and we probably won't know for about 6 months. So I can tell you this, we're not going to back off on pushing for living kidney donor transplants. Donors themselves can return to a normal life and health after donation. I'm proof of it. I'm 74 now. I donated a kidney when I was 62 in a four-way paired kidney exchange. I'm doing pretty well. My creatinine's 1.1 and my BUN is 17, and I have a GFR greater than 60. So if I can do it, a lot of you could donate a kidney. And quite frankly, if all the people who could donate stepped forward, we wouldn't have a waiting list today. Living donor, again, does not have to be related to you. They just have to be a medically approved donor. The surgery itself has changed entirely since I started in transplant 32 years ago. When I started in transplant, it was a huge open incision, almost 15 inches long, starting in the front of the abdomen and going up the back. My incisions, I got three, are about the two of them are the size of my thumb, and the other one is a 4-inch incision at the belt line where they took the kidney out. I was in the hospital overnight, and I was back to work in 2 weeks. Now, if you're doing any type of heavy lifting, construction, stretching, something like that, we require that you take 4 weeks off until the wounds are completely healed. But for me, for what I was doing with no patient care, I could get back to work in 2 weeks. It's performed minimally invasive, what we call a hand-assisted laparoscopic procedure, where they use a camera and a light and ports to put the instruments in and remove the kidney. Again, it takes about 3 or 4 hours to do this surgery. It's generally an overnight stay in the hospital. And you go home on pain medications and a stool softener for a week. And after that, you shouldn't need anything. Now, who pays for all of this for the donor? Does the recipient pay it? And in this case, the recipient doesn't pay it personally, but all the donor tests and operations are paid for eventually by the recipient's insurance company. Prior to that, Northwestern Memorial Hospital is the guarantor of the bill for all workup costs for the kidney, for the surgery, for the in-hospital stay, and for 2 years of follow-up regarding the kidney. Okay, that's all part of the package. Things that won't be covered are room, board, lost wages, travel to and from the hospital. Those are not covered. However, by law, the recipient is allowed to cover those costs for the donor, but certainly not every recipient can do this. And now some insurance companies, recipient insurance companies, are starting to provide expenses for the donor, because it just makes sense. In the long run, they save money by having the patient off of dialysis and with a transplant. Now, there are also funds available through the National Living Donor Assistance Center and some other philanthropic endeavors that we have access to help those people who need money for travel or whatever if they can't get it otherwise. Also, it is illegal in the United States for buy, selling, or trading in human organs. So while you could give your donor up to $14,000 for donating to you to cover expenses, you can't give anybody $100,000 or a new Ferrari in exchange for a kidney. That is against federal law and the National Organ Transplant Act. Now, what happens if somewhere down the road with me, All of a sudden, my remaining kidney goes bad. Is this more likely to happen? Actually, it's not. Though I will tell you that donors do show up on our doorstep at other transplant centers 25 years down the road with kidney failure. And in most cases, it's related to some medical reason, not to that they had the same disease as their recipient or anything like that. In some cases, the biggest cause of kidney failure right now is type 2 diabetes, from bad diet, being overweight, and that type of thing. However, because you are a donor under provisions of the NOTA, National Organ Transplant Act, you get priority points on the waiting list. So if you would go onto the kidney waiting list, your wait would be minimum, because the only one ahead of you are going to be the kids. Sometimes patients who come to us have type 1 diabetics or a special type 2 diabetic, and it's caused their pancreas to quit producing insulin, and therefore they have something called either type 1 diabetes or type 2 diabetes, which can cause a whole bunch of other problems. Patients with type 1 diabetes, which is actually the rarest form of diabetes, is caused by the destruction of beta cells, which actually in the pancreas produce the insulin. And for whatever reason, we're still not sure, the beta cells just quit producing insulin. So overnight, there is no blood sugar control and you have to take insulin. People with type 2 diabetes are a slightly different problem. And there seems to be the result of insulin resistance. And by insulin resistance, it means that these patients, a good majority of them, have what we call metabolic syndrome, which is being overweight, bad diets, a body mass index of greater than 30. And it's not so much they're not making enough insulin. Matter of fact, they're making more than some non-diabetics are. It's the fact that their body has developed a resistance against it, and they're not being able to utilize their own insulin. Now, in some cases, we can transplant these patients, but I'm not going to get into that right now, because the majority of patients who do get transplanted are a type 1 diabetic who's generally gotten in anywhere up to age 39. They've developed. People with type 2 are generally later in life. But diabetes is the number one cause of kidney failure today, high blood pressure being second. Not only does it cause kidney disease, but it can cause severe visual problems with retinopathy, pronounced heart and blood vessel disease with atherosclerotic disease, and also peripheral, what they call neuropathy. In other words, this is nerve damage, where they start losing the sensation in their feet and legs, and while you'll see some diabetics walk a little strangely. But they also, there's a plethora of other disease problems that go along with diabetes. And it's chronic, it's lifelong, and they do not have the life expectancy of someone who does not have diabetes. So who needs a pancreas transplant? Because we can now do that with or without a kidney transplant. People with insulin-dependent diabetes who have kidney disease, our first choice for them is a simultaneous pancreas and kidney transplant. And one of the good things about this, these patients don't have to wait on the kidney list. If it's 3,300 patients here in Illinois, they only have to wait on the pancreas list, because if the pancreas is placed with you, the kidney goes along for the ride. In other words, comes free with it. And there's only 150 patients in the state of Illinois on the list for a kidney and a pancreas. But let's say you come to transplant and you've got a living donor. Maybe it's a brother or sister, maybe it's even a perfect match. Well, you decide, this is what I want to do. I don't want to start dialysis, and I don't want to wait about a year probably or a little bit longer for a kidney and a pancreas transplant, so they get the living donor transplant to avoid dialysis. Well, guess what? We then immediately put them on the list, if they would like, for a pancreas after a kidney. Now, it's more surgery, but again, this can cure their diabetes and prevent it from knocking out their new kidney transplant, which if you don't, if you're still diabetic after you get a kidney transplant, you still run the risk, if you're not tightly controlled, of losing the kidney from diabetic nephropathy. The other reason we do it, and this is rare, a brittle diabetic who has what we refer to as hypoglycemic unawareness. And by that, I mean this is when they don't know when their blood sugars are getting low. They get none of the warning signs, and all of a sudden, they'll just pass out. Well, quite frankly, this is life-threatening. Now, patients who are aware when their blood sugars are getting low, eat a candy bar or something like that, they can tell, they get a funny feeling. But those that don't, they can die. So they will become a candidate for pancreas transplant alone. Successful pancreas will achieve normal glucose levels, it's amazing, without the need for any type of insulin shots or oral type medication. It will reverse kidney damage in some people's kidneys if caught early enough. It can further reduce the amount of peripheral neuropathy that patients are associated with, and it will stabilize visual changes in patients. And there's also a whole bunch of other things. It's not an cure-all, but it definitely improves the quality of life for someone who's had to deal with this terrible disease. At this time, I'd like to introduce you to a couple of my fellow outreach coordinators, Martha Escamilla Arias, who is the social worker, and she is the founding social worker of our 14-year-old Hispanic transplant program here at Northwestern. And after her, I'd like you to meet Shireen Harrington, who is the founding social worker of our new program, the African American Transplant Outreach Program, ATAP for short. So at this time, Martha.
Thank you, Doug. My name is Marta Escamilla. I'm the outreach coordinator and the social worker for the Hispanic transplant program that we have at Northwestern Memorial. In 2006, Dr. Caicedo, Juan Carlos Caicedo, came to Northwestern or explored Northwestern that there was a big population of the Hispanic people that they were not getting services that they needed. He find out that more than 800 Hispanics live in Chicago and almost 2 million of Hispanics live in the Chicago area. And from that population, 75% speak Spanish and just 25 speak English. So he developed the Hispanic program to provide more cultural sensitive and services in their language that the patients need. He also find out that he knew that the Hispanic population have a higher incidence of illness that they lead to kidney failure, like high blood pressure, diabetes, and also the Hispanics, they double the risk of having kidney problems than the white people. Trying to meet this growing population developed this cultural sensitive Hispanic transplant program with having a transplant clinic that we have two clinics every month, and they are totally in Spanish. We have a specific line to refer that patients can be called, or they can be referred by the clinical staff at the dialysis centers or any doctors or insurance managers can send also referrals. We have a complete staff that includes surgeons, hepatologists, social workers, financial coordinators, the support staff, and also we provide the services very cultural sensitive and try to do a good coordination of care. All the materials that we provide for our patients are in Spanish, and the pre-materials, pre-transplant and post-transplant, and also our Spanish-speaking patients, they have the opportunity to be part of the clinical research. Like I said, we have two clinics every month, totally in Spanish. I'm going to introduce my co-worker, who is Shamir Harrington. She is the coordinator and the social worker for the ATAP program.
Thank you, Martha. Good day. Again, my name is Shamir Harrington. I am the outreach coordinator and licensed clinical social worker for the African American Transplant Access Program, also known as ATAP here at Northwestern Medicine. ATAP was founded by Dr. Danae Simpson, who is a transplant surgeon here at Northwestern Medicine, the first African American female transplant surgeon in the state of Illinois. And she began this program to increase transplant access to the black population here in the Chicagoland area. So as you may know, black people represent 13% of the U.S. population, but we also represent 35% of people living with kidney disease here in the U.S. It's also known that black people are nearly four times as likely to develop kidney failure than non-Hispanic white people, according to data that is presented by the National Institutes of Health. You may ask yourself why that is. So black people are more likely to have two of the top causing diseases for kidney disease, which is diabetes and high blood pressure. We also, or black people also have a possible genetic predisposure for kidney disease. And then also because of what we call social determinants of health, which includes economic stability, neighborhood living and conditions, access to education, access to healthy food options, access to preventative care medicine, as well as access to specialty health care. So when we consider all these things, just our exposure to certain health conditions, our genetics, as well as social determinants of health, all of these things play a part in our access to transplantation. So African Americans or black people are less likely to access kidney transplants. We are also less likely to receive kidneys from a living donor. And we are also less likely to complete or go through an evaluation process. So ATAP was formed by Dr. Simpson in order to improve education and to provide access to the black community. And so we do this by just having a clinic in the community. It's a clinic located in Oakland, where we have access to nursing staff, a surgeon is present, and then we also have a social worker there that will help you to get not only through the evaluation process, but our hope is to also get you listed and ultimately transplanted. So if you or someone you know may be interested in the ATAP program, please feel free to contact us here at Northwestern or reach out to your social worker at the dialysis center so they can send a referral over to us. And we would love to come alongside of you and your family as you navigate the transplant process.
Thank you, Martha and Shamir, for that important input on your programs. Just to end this up, I'd like to show you rankings that are from this past year for the transplant programs in both Chicago and the nation in terms of living donor kidney transplant programs. Of which we were Was that 13? I believe that's where we are in the country. We also are the largest kidney transplant center in Illinois. We did 243 kidney transplants last year, of which 165 were deceased donors and 78 were living donors. And then the other centers are listed below that. And this is all data, by the way. It's based upon UNOS out of the OPTN, Organ Procurement Transplant Network, as of February the 10th, 2021. Looking at pancreas transplants over the last 10 years, even though we were not really the first program in Illinois to have a full-time pancreas transplant program, we just did the first one in Illinois and then didn't do any for another 24 years. But we more than caught up in that time and now lead in the number of transplant programs over the past 10 years. Though the University of Illinois is trying to catch up with us there this past year. It's a pretty intense business. Looking at patient survivals, our patient survivals here at Northwestern meet all the criteria and conditions of participation by CMS in the end-stage renal disease program. CMS being the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services. Our one-year patient survival is 97.4%. The national experience is 97.6%. Our living donor transplant patient survival is 99.12%. The country is 99.01%. Our one-year graft survival is 95.43%. The national 95.75%. For living donor, 98.3 and 98.02 national experience. For pancreas transplants, there's only one, and that's the kidney survival rate. There's not enough pancreas transplant to establish adequate information. So there has never been a statistic for patient or graft survival in someone who got a pancreas transplant. Our leadership team here, starts with Dr. Joe Leventhal, who is the interim chief right now of the surgical director of the kidney transplant program. Danae Simpson, who Shamir mentioned. Dr. John Friedewald, who's the medical director of the kidney and pancreas transplant program. Nitin Catania, our surgical director for pancreas. And of course, Dr. Juan Carlos Caicedo, who is director of the Hispanic Transplant Program and the Living Transplant Program. Someone who hasn't been mentioned is Greg Secura, who actually leads up our team and is the director, program director for program development and business development here at Northwestern in transplant. The outreach program has been in effect now for more than 20 years, providing both patient and professional education for nephrologists and others. Patient works with patients approaching or currently undergoing dialysis, providers and staff members, nephrologists, primary care physicians, and professional groups such as the National Kidney Foundation and the Illinois Transplant Fund to facilitate transplant services to all. And again then, Greg Secura is our director, Martha, Shamir, myself, and Aisha Green, who is our administrative assistant and takes on a huge load of work. I'd like to end at this time. Thank you for your patience and your understanding today. If you wish to get an appointment with us for a pre-transplant eval, please call 312-695-0828. Thank you.